The step attribute determines whether we display the trends as a stair step function, as you can see right here. This would be a stair step function, or if we simply connect the dots, which is what you're seeing right here. We connect the dots from here to here, here to here. So let me illustrate. Let me go ahead and show you a tag definition. This is the tag CDT158, and if we look at the actual display of that, here's where it looks, what it looks like with step turned off. What we're doing is we're connecting the dots between the actual archive values. Now if I go in here into the archive section, set step equal to on, and go ahead and save this, within a few seconds process book picks up that change and it's going to start displaying this as a stair step function. As you can see, now it's showing up with a stair step function instead of the traditional connecting the dots function. Now this does have implications when it comes to how data compression is done. We haven't discussed data compression yet, but as we go through the class, you'll notice that we don't store every single value. We're storing values only when they reach peaks and valleys of Now, not only does this affect how it's displayed, but there are some subtle changes to the data compression algorithm. When a tag has step turned on, then the compression test is done more like a straight boxcar test, where we're not checking for slope anymore, we're just checking for going beyond the dead band. Now, we haven't discussed data compression and compression specs yet. We'll discuss that later on, and at that point we'll mention this again. There's some other things that are going to happen when you set step equal to on, some other implications. You can see all these listed in the notes section of your class lecture notes. For example, when you're doing things like averages, we do different types of calculations, simple averages versus interpolated averages. When we set step equal to on versus step equal to off, there's of course the stair step line, the plot, as you can see. So in general, what we suggest is any type of laboratory data, manual entered data of any type, and any averages, in addition, set points should be set with step equal to on, and just about every other type of data should not have step turned on. We looked at point types a little bit earlier. Let's concentrate now on some unusual point types. Let's look at float 16 first of all. Float 16 is a type of point that is designed really to save on disk space and to maintain compatibility with earlier versions of Pi. And it has a couple of advantages. It's smaller, as you would imply, the name would imply, a 16 versus a float 32, but it is not as accurate. It does have some built-in features. You might be interested in kind of in clamping on the zero and span of a tag so that the values, it's not possible to go below the zero or above the zero plus the span. And a float 16 will do that automatically. That's in fact a restriction. So you wouldn't have to build a separate Pi tag in order to make that clamping. The other thing is it reduces disk space required because it's just not as big on disk. Now some of the reasons you might not want to do it, well, the same thing you might call a feature is also a liability. It cannot archive anything beyond the span. So, you know, if you have a level that goes from 0 to 100%, sometimes it may actually, because of calibration problems, go up to 101% or something. Well, this is going to stay clamped at 100%, and it also does bring a rounding error. So, unless you have a specific need, we suggest you really kind of avoid the float 16s. Here's an illustration you'll find in your book in the notes section that describes exactly what's going on with a float 16. With a float 16, you know, what basically you're going to do is for when you get a value that's a real number, for example this 250.9 that you see right here, 250.9 is not how we're going to be storing it in the system. In fact, what we'll do is we'll look at where that falls on the scale of the instrument itself, 0 to 500. We'll figure out what that is. That's 50.18% of the range. And we just map that to the same range of 0 to 32767. That's actually 2 to the 16th. And then the, or excuse me, 2 to the 15th. And we map that, so 50.18% ends up being 16442. But in fact, we're storing this as an integer. So You have to basically take that off, and that's what leads to this rounding error. So you do have a rounding error. The rounding error is equivalent to the span times 1 over 32,767, or in other words, the span times ends up being 3/100,000ths. So in conclusion, we would suggest that, again, unless you've got some real specific reason, you don't typically want to go with a float 16. Put it in perspective, though, up until after the first 15 years of the history of OSI, every single Pi point that had ever been created was a float 16. So it's not a bad format. It's just something that we don't strongly recommend anymore. Now, we also have the choice of between float 32 and float 64, and it really has to do with how much precision you need. So, for example, float 32 is going to be a single precision reel with up to 7 significant digits. So a number like this, we're going to end up having fewer significant digits to display than if you were doing that same thing as a float 64. String tags and blob tags are used for storing out-of-the-ordinary data. For example, with a string tag, you can store operator comments. For example, any kind of manual entries or messages. That's all something we can put in string tags. Now, it's not supported commonly by all of our interfaces. So it is something we'd have to demonstrate making use of this using some of our other tools. So for example, I've got a tag here called myString. I just created a tag. Its point type is string. And here is an example we have available on our training website. This is called putval example 1. You'll actually find the same type of example in your own PyPC directory under Excel. There's some examples. This one's just a very simplistic one. So what I'd like to do is write the value of test 4 of string. I've already tested this 3 times. We'll go ahead and write that value to Pi. Let me refresh the screen here. It's at 9:20 a.m. And we send that to Pi, and it now has been written. So let's see if I can't retrieve it. Let me just get the last 1 hour of data. I'll choose Pi. Compressed data start and end time. So my tag name is going to be there. My start time is going to be there. My end time is right here. We'll show the timestamps. And here it is. As you can see, that value of the string has been written. Here are the other tests that I did. So it is supported among our clients, and it is a nice mechanism for doing a type of an online log report if you're interested in that. Now the second thing listed here are these blob tags. And blob tags, again, this stands for binary large object. Eventually, we'd like to be able to store things like JPEG files or WAV files. So this is what we envision for the blob tags. The display digits attribute controls how we display this by default in process book. Let me show you what I'm talking about. You have a field that takes either a positive or a negative integer. Positive indicates number of decimal places. Negative indicates significant digits. So, for example, a positive 5 would indicate 5 decimal places for display in process book. Now, let me show you an example. If I look at process book right now, this is my Pi tag, and I'm looking here at a display that is probably, this is showing us 5 significant digits, so this is probably set up with a display digits of -5. Let's take a look at the definition of the tag. Now I'm going to switch over to our Pi system management tools, and we will take a look at this tag called CDT 158. This is the point builder, just another way of editing Pi tags. Now if we look at this, you can see there it is. Display digits is set as -5. -5 indicating 5 significant digits. Let me change that to a positive 5. I'll go ahead and save the changes, and look what happens when we change back to process book. All of a sudden we're seeing 5 decimal places instead of 5 significant digits. So this is going to control that. I'll set this back to -5, save the changes, and now within a few seconds, there we go, we see this is coming back using 5 significant digits at this point. So that's how that's what display digits is controlling. Now there are a number of attributes that are simply assigned by the system. So for example, things like point ID, record number, creator, creation date, changer, change date, these are all things that you really don't have any control over. And you'll find those, every PyTag has these. It's simply kind of documenting the creation and change date, and also this internal ID that we use in some of our applications, and our record number for storing in the archive. So we don't have to spend a lot of time working on that. Lastly, we do have some attributes that can control some fundamentals, and they're pretty self-explanatory. For example, with scan equal to on, it simply means that we are going to be actively scanning this tag by whatever interface or application is writing to that tag. So scan off would effectively shut down the interface without deleting it. Archiving turns on and off whether we archive the data or not. And shutdown, well, shutdown works this way. Whenever the Pi server is shut down, a shutdown event, which is a digital state, simply the word shutdown, is going to be written into the archive at the point at which the Pi server is shut down for all of the tags that have that shutdown flag set equal to 1. Now, there are other mechanisms for indicating that. For example, we can do very much the same thing on the interface level. And so later on, we're going to be discussing in general how to set up these kind of shutdown notifications.